Michael Pardee was the director at the time of outreach for the Boniek Institute at Rice University. The Boniek Institute is an institute for the study and advancement of religious tolerance. And Michael told me about a project they've been working on for several years, a program called SSQ, Sacred Sites Quest. And he explained to me that this was a project where they got high school students together from all around the city of Houston. And they took those high school students to lots of different sacred sites in the Houston area. Houston is the most international city in America. They have more representation of the international community than any other city in America, which is really kind of hard for even us to believe. But it's true. And the demographers say that if you want to know what America's going to look like in 20 years, you should come to Houston now. So here you are. So he explained to me that he had these high school kids that were going to start in on a new year of this project. And typically what they've done the first 3 years is they go to these sacred sites, synagogues, mosques, the Quaker Meeting House, Buddhist temples, Hindu temples, all over the city of Houston, the Baha'i Center, the Roscoe Chapel, Labyrinths. And they just think about people's spiritual journeys and how they are different and how they are the same. And they have conversations about this. And in the end, he said, we have this public artist in Houston that works with the kids to take what they've learned and channel it into a public art project. And Mike said that what he had hoped this year was maybe their public art project would be a labyrinth. And we began to talk excitedly about labyrinths. And before we were done with the conversation, he said, I just think we need to hire you to be the labyrinth coach for our project. I had no idea there even was such a job as a labyrinth coach. And I thought about it for a minute and I accepted the position. And he said, we're going to meet up next week and we're all going to sit down and plan. And when he said we all, he included Reginald Adams, who was the public artist that had been working with him for 3 years. So Reginald, when I met Reginald, he was equally enthusiastic about a labyrinth project, but at the same time, wanting to know more about labyrinths. So Reginald and I began conversations about labyrinths and what I knew about labyrinths. And the question I kept hearing from people was, well, have you ever built a labyrinth before, the labyrinth coach? And I said, you know, I never built one before. So between Mike and Reginald and I, we found a property that was in need, a place that wanted to preserve a sacred past. And Reginald, Mike found students to work with us. And Reginald knows through ample years of experience how to take a group of people and turn them into a well-oiled machine for public art. And he took the same magic he'd worked on murals and mosaics all over the city of Houston, and he began working that magic on labyrinths. I will tell you a little bit about what I've learned about Reginald. He said last night, when you travel with people, you get to know them really well, and I would say, that is true. When we were traveling in France with a group of kids to build a labyrinth in Lyon, we got to know each other really well. And what I found out about Reginald is I've never met anyone in my life, and I've worked with a lot of fascinating and talented people, never met anyone in my life who can manifest his dreams as easily as Reginald can. I could give you 5 or 6 or 7 examples of miracles that have happened in our journeys just because Reginald had the faith to believe that they would happen. And the labyrinth in Lyon was one of those. We arrived in Lyon, we weren't even sure we had a site. We had kids to build. We had built up this thing for months. We arrived in Lyon, we didn't even know we had a site for sure that we were going to build on. We went to the hardware store to get the materials for the build, and they were ready to give us all the materials, which Reginald had already gotten at half price through contacts. And he said, we can do this, we'll get all this together. And then they said, well, we can deliver them on Wednesday. And our flight was ready to leave, and we have our flight booked out of France on Wednesday. And this was the prior Thursday. And we said, no, we can't wait till Wednesday to get the materials to the site. And within minutes, right, this truck driver comes in and says, I just had a delivery canceled. I hate it when I get these deliveries canceled. And the guy at the cash register said, well, do you want to deliver for these guys? Sure. Well, can you do it right now? Right now. Just tell me. And we jumped into a car and a van and followed the truck to the site so that they could get those bricks delivered. It just was one thing after another like that. And if you follow Reginald around very much, you find that happens over and over and over again, just through the energy of his spirit and his will. So I'm very excited to introduce my friend Reginald Adams to you this afternoon, and he's going to share his labyrinth journey with you.
So, first of all, welcome to Houston. I'm a little nervous, so you got to work with me through kind of butterflies in my stomach, but very excited to be here. As Jane mentioned, we've had an opportunity to grow together, and it's really largely in part to Jane. I've absolutely fallen in love with the labyrinth and all of the people and the experiences that I've had that have allowed me to grow my work creatively. But I think before I can get into our labyrinth work, I think it's worth noting how I got into public art, and more specifically, placemaking, because there's something very unique about taking a site that may be overlooked or completely off the radar, transforming it into a cultural or artistic, or in some cases, a spiritual destination. But to start my path, I have to go back to Flagstaff, Arizona, where I was in kindergarten, 5 years old, in Mrs. Woodson's class. And this is all about keep walking. Right? No matter what happens in your life, keep walking. I think that's the metaphor of the labyrinth, is that we have to stay on our path. And once we discover that path, oftentimes it leads us to our purpose. So here I am. I was that kid, and some of y'all probably know children like this who love to draw. And so every opportunity that I was afforded, I was drawing. As long as I had a pencil or a crayon or a marker or a pen and a piece of paper, and sometimes I didn't even need paper. You can ask my parents, I have writings all over the walls. But I loved to draw. And so by the time I'd gotten into kindergarten, I had drawn all my action figures, all my Hot Wheels, all my comic books, and if you stood still long enough, I was gonna draw you. So that assignment, that day in Ms. Woodson's class, was to draw all of our basic shapes. She had all the basic shapes on the chalkboard, and she had them colored with primary and secondary colors, so she'd given all the kids crayons to match. And that was our task, was to draw these shapes just as we saw them. And I was excited. As I'm excited today sharing this story with you all, I was excited to show Miss Woodson what I could do. So I had taken my square and I turned it into a cube, right? And I'd taken my triangle and I turned it into a pyramid. And my rectangle became, my rectangle became a prism. I put even a lid on it. And I'd taken my circle and I shaded it really well and put a little shadow under there and turned it into a sphere. Colored it with all of my crayons. And so I could see Miss Woodson walking throughout the class, giving some children pointers and helping them clean up their work. And I felt her come behind me, I felt that presence, and very pridefully I looked up at her, and she asked for my paper. And she raises my paper above her head. She says, everybody, I'd like for you to look at Reggie's work. And yes, you can call me Reggie. And so she begins to show the class what I had done, and she starts to tear my paper in pieces. And then she takes my crayons, and she begins to crush them into 1,000 little pieces right before my eyes. So as you feel this kind of shock and awe of that experience, you imagine what a five-year-old felt. I was angry, I was frustrated, I was upset, I couldn't understand it. And then she goes on to share, why did she do this? She said, I didn't draw exactly what was on the board. And as devastating as that was then, 39 years ago, it was probably one of the most important and valuable lessons that I've ever had in my art career. Because what I gained from that experience with Ms. Woodson is that I was determined to not let anyone take me off my path. And so I never stopped drawing. And in fact, I drew more feverishly. And that never stopped. And that was really the beginning of a journey that has allowed me to meet some incredible people, manifest some unbelievable works of art, but all with the help of other people. And I've learned in my work how to harness human capital. And you'll see a few examples of this work. So this is a little bit of a show and tell, and then we're gonna walk into how I moved from an artist to a public artist to now a sacred space builder. And so, let's see if we can get this technology cooperating. So I tell that story about Ms. Woodson because it brings me to the idea of this notion of being Crayola crushers, right? And we meet them all the time. I mean, I think for my entire life I've met Crayola crushers, and these are people, even unbeknownst to them, try to stop you or try to prevent you from achieving what you know is right for you. And I still meet them to this day. The stakes are just higher. And so I tell the children primarily that we get a chance to work with, I tell them this story because every day we meet obstacles. Sometimes it's the people closest to us that try to keep us off our path, they try to take us off our path. And oftentimes they don't even realize what they're doing. They think it's for your own good. But most times they're projecting their own insecurities and their own fears on you. And so I've learned, because of the ability to take a blank piece of paper or a blank canvas and transform it into a work of art, that we can pretty much create anything we want. And I think Jay kind of testified to that. I have a strong belief that whatever we have in our minds, if we believe in it enough, we can manifest it. And it's really why we're here. It's why this gathering is here today. Because I think 2 years ago, I don't know if TLS was thinking that they'd be in Houston. And here we are 24 months later, and we have 100 plus people celebrating the power of the path. And it's just a testament to all of the work that TLS has done. And certainly, I have to acknowledge my co-chair, Karen Kelly. If she's in the room, where's Karen? Is she here? All right, well, everybody has met Karen, and I wouldn't be here if it had not been for Karen. This event wouldn't be here if it not for Karen. So please thank her, give her a big hug. She is working crazy behind the scenes, making this happen. And so again, it's about staying focused on what you do. So that's my story about perseverance. And then around 8 years old, I ended up visiting the Grand Canyon. And it was an awakening because my parents, as supportive as they were of my creativity, they didn't really have a strong interest in me becoming an artist. Both of my parents are business people. My father's a Harvard graduate, so he saw me walk in that path. So the artwork was cute, but that wasn't really what was gonna get me a real job, right? And so I remember going to the Grand Canyon for the first time, and by show of hands, who's been to the Grand Canyon before? All right, wonderful. So if you've been, I don't really have to spend a lot of time telling you how majestic and how awesome the Grand Canyon is. And so imagine an 8-year-old kid standing at the northern rim, seeing this picture, who has this love for color, right? And I remember that day thinking, whatever an artist is, that's what I wanna be. I wanna create big, beautiful things. And that evolved into some of the work that's happening now. There were some other things that happened that were pivotal in my life. It's a really interesting picture. So around 20 years ago, I ended up meeting this amazing lady named Rhonda Radford. And she was an artist, and we were putting together local art shows in Houston. And I was working for a community art center here, and they had given me a ticket plus one to our gala, which happened to be a costume party. And around that time in my art career, I was creating body paintings. So I had a friend of mine who was a photographer. He was a fashion photographer, so he could get all these hot models. And I was at that age where I wanted to be around hot models, and this was my way of kind of using my artwork and at the same time doing something kind of innovative. So I had this kind of collection of photographs that we had captured, and we had a ticket to this, I had an extra ticket to this gala, and I called Rhonda up. We'd never been on a date before, and I said, "Hey, Rhonda, I've seen your work, and I'd love if you could join me to this gala. It's for Project Row House. It's a really cool art space in Third Ward." She said, "Sure." I said, "Well, before you say sure, I think I need to disclose something." I said, "I'd love if we could both go body paint." There's this awkward silence on the phone. I said, "Well, let me explain. It's probably not what you're thinking. You'd wear a leotard, a bodysuit, and I would do the same, and you'd paint on me, and I'd paint on you." And she reluctantly said yes. So that afternoon, or actually it was the following day, she came over to my studio, and we spent the day body painting each other and got to know each other really, really well. That night, we show up at the Franklin Ballroom, which is downtown here. It's a historic, beautiful, no, the Magnolia Ballroom on Franklin and Milo. It's a beautiful historic space. And we got into the costume party late, or to the gala late. So as we walk in, they're rushing us to the front of the staging area where they're about to have the best costume contest. And here we are amongst all the other, attendees, and everybody's kind of dressed up differently, but nothing like what we were. So when we walk in, first of all, upon first impressions, everyone thought we were new. I know these artists did not come up here butt naked. But as they were able to kind of see what we were wearing, they realized we had bodysuits on, so they rushed us to the front. Long story short, we ended up winning first place for the best costumes. Surprise, surprise. And that afforded us an opportunity. The first place prize were two round trip tickets to Paris, France. Oh. Exactly. This is a first date, right? Yes. I'm kind of stubborn in a lot of ways because I knew that this was the lady for me. I knew this. Like, if this can happen and just meeting someone and having this kind of experience, this is the person I need to be with. So while we're in Paris, visiting all the beautiful things of France, we ended up getting a Eurorail pass, and we had about 3 weeks to kind of travel around, and we ended up in another really magical place that was very pivotal to my creative work, and that was Barcelona, Spain, right? And I had seen mosaics before. I'd seen them in restaurants and perhaps maybe at a museum, but I'd never seen anything like the work of Antonio Gaudí. If you've been to Barcelona, and you've seen any of Gaudi's work, you know how magnificent his artistry is. And so, as an artist, really at the cusp of my public art career, I was mesmerized. And right around that time, I'd gotten some grant funding to do some projects here in Houston. And never having touched a piece of tile before, I decided to create these three murals, which I was initially gonna paint, in mosaics. And I fell in love with the medium. I fell in love with the ability of taking these random size, shape, colored pieces of tile and stones and rocks and putting them together to create this ideal image. And it really became a metaphor for the communities that I was working in. Because just like in this room, we have people of all different ages and genders and backgrounds and social economic demographics, but we make up the TLS Labyrinth community. We're a mosaic of people. And I kept seeing this analogy between the artwork, the media, and these communities. And that started moving me into creating these public spaces. And then another magical experience happened. I met with some Rotarians. And they said, "Reggie, you would be a perfect candidate to go on a group study exchange." How many of y'all are familiar with Rotary? Raise your hands. All right, good. So, about 7 years ago, I was one of five Houstonians, young professionals, that they chose to travel to Turkey. And Istanbul it's a mystical, magical, ancient city. And again, all throughout, the mosque and these ancient sacred spaces are mosaics, floor to ceiling. And it just captivated me. And I was bringing all of these travel experiences back to Houston. Every time we'd go somewhere new, I try to bring a little bit of that flavor back to this city, back into my work. And this helped me expand upon my own cultural awareness. And so over the course of the last 18 plus years, since 1999, I've been very honored and blessed to have created over 200 public art projects. And not alone. As you'll see in just a few minutes, if you've had a chance to witness this is work created and designed by our youth. Because I'm very passionate about empowering these students. And so we have now close to 40,000 young people throughout the city who are claiming these projects as their own because they are the co-creators of this work. And so this begins our journey in placemaking. So this is just a collage of a fraction of these 200 plus projects. And so these are in neighborhoods that we are strategically targeting to ensure that if that child never comes across the street to the MFA, or never goes across the street to the Contemporary Arts Museum, or to all of these wonderful art spaces here in the Museum District. And it's a surprise, we think, oh, of course people do. But I meet children time and time again for a variety of reasons that never come to these spaces. So I built this ideology that we would turn the city of Houston into a gallery space. And we would go to those who could not come to us by creating these public art projects in their community. So that as they drive down their streets or as they play in their school playgrounds, they get a chance to experience and participate in the creative process by not only looking at the work, but being co-creators of it. And here's a few examples of those projects. So when I first started showing these slides for presentations and for RFPs and requests for qualifications, I would usually just show the final piece, right? You want to show the final work to let people know what was done. But then people would say, oh my God, Reginald, that's so awesome. You're a great artist. That's cool, right? And I realized, this wasn't really my work. This was the student's work. So I started adding these collages around the perimeter of these final pieces so that people could see that it really wasn't just Reginald behind these incredible public art projects. It's these students that are in the studio collaborating, brainstorming, kind of fighting out ideas to create some of Houston's best, in my opinion, public art. And so this is a project out in North Houston. This is a wonderful sculpture. There were several other sculptural elements that were part of this. And I still see some of these students to this day. This project is about 10 years old. This is another project that we worked on in North Houston. It's called The Blossoms of Cashmere Gardens. I love sacred geometry. And so we try to share this with students to introduce them to math in a very different, non-threatening way. Here the students are in the studio learning the geometry, just using a simple straight edge and ruler. We give them a chance to color their designs. We show them how to turn their designs into these mosaics. And here, this community center, which is just blocks away from the school where these kids came from, imagine being 12 or 13 years old, and in some cases even younger, driving down the street, the main street of your neighborhood, and being able to point out to window to your brothers or your sisters or your cousins or your aunts and uncles, I did that. Imagine the power that comes from a young person being able to create a work of art that creates a space, a new space in their own neighborhood. I fell in love with this notion. And so we continue building these relationships across Houston with these young people. And here's one in my own neighborhood. I live in the Fifth Ward. Fifth Ward is one of Houston's oldest, most historic African-American communities. Founded back in 1835, this neighborhood is just on the cusp of downtown. And so when my wife and I and my son moved to Fifth Ward about 15 years ago, and I started getting involved in the community, I was sitting in a room with some elders, and they were talking about the gentrification that's taking place. And I think across the nation, in most of our urban core, those neighborhoods that kind of surround downtown that were historically kind of the neighborhoods for the service workers and for those people of color, they're being transformed. And it's happening here in Houston. So I'm listening to these elders talk about their fear of this neighborhood being erased, the history of it being erased. And not really knowing much about the history of Fifth Ward, I started doing my homework and I started finding out that there's this amazing list of personalities that have come out of this community. People like Congresswoman Barbara Jordan, first African-American Congresswoman, the world champion boxer George Foreman, internationally known jazz musician Joe Sample. And the list goes on and on. And I realized, wow, this is amazing that these people came from this you know, poor African-American neighborhood. This story has to be told. And so in the spirit of manifesting a dream, shortly after doing a little bit of this homework, I got on the internet and found a grant opportunity from the History Channel. And they had a project for saving the history of a local community. It wasn't about saving the history of Houston. They wanted a local community. So I wrote a grant and got funding, and we turned that $10,000 grant into a $150,000 project. And we spent about 2 years educating students who went to the schools that most of these historical leaders came from about these personalities. And out of that work came this mural. This mural is 15 feet high, 65 feet long. There's about a million pieces of tile that were laid within 3 months by high school students. So at the culmination of that summer public art program, this is what they were able to gift to their community. One of the most prideful moments that I've had in my career was the day of the dedication, where all of these families came out. The people connected to the personalities on the wall. We had historical figures dating back to the early 18th century or 19th century, all the way up to contemporary leaders of today. So all of their families and people connected to them and the businesses that they're tied to and all of the students and their families. So there was about 4,000 people in front of this wall the day that we dedicated it. And to hear those kids talk about their pride and their joy and realizing that these great leaders walked the same sidewalks, they went to the same elementary school, the same middle school, the same high school that they went to, was an opportunity to let them see that they too can achieve greatness no matter where you come from. And so that began another catalyst in my work. And that was focusing on the history and the heritage of these communities. So that fast forwards us to around 2011 when I met Mike Pardee, and Jay Staley referenced Mike earlier. I was asked to serve on the advisory board of the Boniek Institute for Religious Tolerance. And I am probably the biggest heathen in this room. So I'm wondering, why would they ask an artist who doesn't go to church, I don't know the Bible, to serve on this kind of board? And the lady who had asked me to serve says, Reginald, we really kind of just need an outside perspective. And we're thinking about doing some things with youth, so I think you'd be a great candidate. I was like, sure. So that year, the same year that I was asked to serve on the board, Mike Pardee comes on board. And he is an amazing youth leader, just a phenomenal person in seeing how to guide youth, empower them in education. So Mike and I sat down over a cup of coffee and we started talking about what could we do through the Boniek to reach a new audience. And I was very interested in taking the work of the Boniek and extending it to a younger generation. And so out of that came this project called the Sacred Site Quest. And Jay mentioned it earlier. We would take up to 30 high school kids who came from all across the city, and we'd visit sacred spaces, churches, cathedrals, temples, mosques, and we would create a public art project at the culmination of this tour. And so I won't spend a lot of time talking about what Jay referenced, because we ended up making this labyrinth in Freedmanstown, and it was an amazing experience, but it was the catalyst for what I'm doing now. And that's using the labyrinth as a tool for building community. And so that following year, we ended up creating the Freedmanstown Labyrinth. And it was all about bringing these kids together, bringing the community together to celebrate the history of Freedmanstown, another historic African-American community. Here are just slides of that work in progress. And here's an aerial view of the final piece. You can imagine these kids seeing their work from this perspective, another awe-inspiring opportunity for them. And that launched us into a new opportunity. And some of you all, I thank you for your support. We launched a GoFundMe campaign about 2 years ago. where I have the vision to take students from Houston and have a sacred site quest in France. And it was an unbelievable experience. I'll tell you, one of the exciting things that came out of this is kind of dovetailing into the present moment. About a month ago, maybe it was a little longer, Tracy Keeling, she's emailing me. It's like the middle of the night, I hear my phone ding. And I'm looking at it, and Tracy's like, I'm in France, or I'm on my way to Lyon, and I'd love to walk your labyrinth. It's, you know, who do I call? And I'm thinking, oh my God, it's 3 o'clock in the morning, this lady, what's she doing? She realized what time it is, she wants to walk a labyrinth. And I'm thinking, okay, so she's 7 hours later, it's actually early morning. And so the labyrinth is located in a private space. It's adjacent to the Basilica de Fauvier, which is at the highest point of the city. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site on the grounds of a university campus. So I'm feverishly texting all the people that I think could open up the door for Tracy. And lo and behold, we got to the right person, and Tracy was able to walk the labyrinth. And we send pictures to the kids, and they're in love because people they know and people that they're meeting are able to embrace and celebrate the power of their work. So again, imagine being 16 years old and being able to leave a legacy in a foreign country that's being celebrated by people from all over the world. I fell in love with that. So when we got back from France, I said, well, actually, we weren't even back from France. And these are just, I mean, these are the kids celebrating their time together. Could you imagine being a teenager standing on the wall overlooking the city of Lyon, busting a yoga pose? That's what we do. Yes. So we're working together. Here are the kids digging their trench, preparing their labyrinths. And you know, one thing about our labyrinths, I have to say, our labyrinths have a lot of character, right? I know there's some very prolific labyrinth builders in the room, and I honor and respect their technique. Because oftentimes I kind of like, when I look at our work, I was like, ooh, those stones are a little rocky for our work. But I think it gives character. But most importantly, it's an opportunity for our kids to do something. So this is the labyrinth. This is what they left in France. And this is around the time we get a phone call from our funder, and they're telling us, well, we're loving what we're seeing. We're sending all these pictures back, and they were sending video, and we're doing social media. And we get a call from the funder, and they ask, would you guys be interested in going to Ecuador? And I called Jay up, and I was like, Jay, guess what? They want us to go to Ecuador. Jay already has a connection in Ecuador, right? So we had even talked. He was like, oh, I got a friend that owns a coffee farm, and she has connections to a spiritual retreat center, and maybe somehow, some way, they could get us to come to Ecuador. This was like, I don't know, a month before we'd even gotten to France. And so the funder wants to send us to Ecuador. Boom, stars align. And so that puts us on a fast track, and we start all over again. We have a very intense 9-month curriculum where we expose the students to science, technology, engineering, the arts, and math, all to design their labyrinth. And so when we get back from France, in the height of the excitement, one of the young ladies, Francesca Ferris, who's like really one of our veteran questers, she is so excited. She writes her own proposal. She gets some grant funding to create a labyrinth at another community arts center called Mecca over in our Sixth Ward. And this was her labyrinth that won her a Girl Scout Gold Award. And, you know, how do you not love this work? You know, these are teenagers, right? Recognizing the significance and the importance of bringing these sacred spaces to these inner city urban neighborhoods. And so the day of the dedication, all the kids are there, the mariachi band was there, the students who made the mosaic stepping stones, and there Francesca is describing the journey. They built the entire summer program curriculum after her idea, and now she is building labyrinths around the country. And so we're honored to have these young people in our city creating these new spaces, creating these new labyrinths so that our communities can enjoy them. And then that led to, and these are probably in no particular order, actually, for those who's gonna be around Sunday, All right, so we're gonna build some labyrinths on the beach. I started seeing Denny Dyke. I started seeing his work. I was like, whoa, this guy's amazing. And so we have a beach about 45 minutes away. So we took some rakes and a string, and we started building our own labyrinths on the beach. So I'm excited to be able to do that with you all Sunday. And then we started getting calls now. Because people were like, hey, there's some labyrinth builders in Houston. And we actually started making some money off some of this stuff. And that created an opportunity for us to build a labyrinth at Sharpstown International High School. So here the students are kind of plotting and planning, using their math ideas to create, I'd say probably one of the most unique labyrinths I've ever seen, right? And they came up with this. These students came up with this idea, these ideas. And this is really beautiful because it's actually a processional labyrinth. But the day that we dedicated the piece, we had the students entering one side, and Jay and I are in the center to offer them their certificates of completion, and they're able to exit out the backside. Now, I should have a before picture because prior to this labyrinth, this was just a very underutilized and neglected space. And now it's become a focal point for this campus and an opportunity for these kids to be able to reflect and meditate and just escape all of the challenges that they confront going through their lives as teenagers.
Tell them about the benches.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Jay. So on top of these mosaics, prior to our arrival on this campus, their art teacher, bless her heart, tried to experiment with mosaics, and really it left a mess. It was a hot mess. And the first time that I saw it, I was like, oh my God, what happened here? And she, you know, was very apologetic. She experimented with some materials that just were not compatible. Long story short, we worked with our kids, and they all drew sacred geometry patterns, which we then transferred onto tile, which are then overlaid on top of these mosaic tiles. And so if you were able to go, you would see individual designs by each one of these students that now embellish and provide functional seating, but also add to the creative and spiritual nature of this space. Did I do well, Jay?
Yeah.
All right, thanks. And then we were invited to create a really special spot. How many of y'all have been to Villa de Mattel? Okay, a few, probably some of the locals. So I'd say one of the most unique, and we have a lot of them here, so I'm a little biased because our labyrinth is there, but one of the most unique sacred spaces in Houston is called Villa de Mattel. It's a 75-acre retreat, spiritual retreat center in South Houston. And about a year ago, it was almost this time that we were invited to design and build an 80-foot shark's design. And so just to give you a sense of scale, this is my wife, Rhonda, here. Yeah. And this was right after we had inlaid the sod. It was a wonderful learning journey for Jay and I because I think we both are, you know, we learn as we go and we try to consult with the professionals, figure out, you know, what works and what doesn't work. But what comes out of this journey are very organic and authentic expressions of love and commitment to this work. And I'm thankful to have people like Jay in my life that push me. It's like, Reggie, we got a new call. Let's do a new project. Let's do a new labyrinth. And I have people like Lars, who I can look at and see his work that inspired me, and Robert Ferrer, who's doing work. And this is our reference point. These become the connections to drive us to continue doing this work, regardless of how much experience we do or don't have. And so if you do get some time, if you're in Houston, I encourage you to go here. It is probably one of our most beautiful labyrinths in the city. They've now landscaped around it. There's some beautiful trails, but this was the beginning. Yes, and thank you, Sarah, for that. And so, we just got back from Ecuador. As I was speaking earlier, before we left France, our funder said, hey, we'd love for you to go to Ecuador. We started, you know, begging for dollars to get these kids there, very successful in getting what we needed to take 18 students and 10 adults to build a labyrinth on the equator. And I'm excited and a little nervous because I just got this documentary. It's about 20 minutes long, about 20 minutes ago. So I haven't even seen it yet. So I'm going to apologize in advance if there's any kind of technical issues, but otherwise, I'd like to share with you a little bit of our journey this summer. So with that said, get your popcorn ready, and let's see if we can get this going. Labyrinth is an ancient spiritual archetype. It's not to be confused with a maze. Maze is designed as a puzzle. It's really an enigma. Its purpose is to trick and puzzle the user. If you think about mazes, they have multiple entrances, multiple exits, they have false turns, they have dead ends, they have cul-de-sacs, and it's really something to confuse the person who's working or walking through it, or even if you're using your hand or maybe even on paper. Whereas a labyrinth has a singular focus, and that is for spiritual reflection, meditation, and contemplation.
My interpretation of a labyrinth is more cultural than anything else. It's a way to release your stress. Whenever you walk into the labyrinth, that's the time when you reflect. Whenever you get to the center, you're supposed to absorb, and just whenever you walk out, you release.
The Sacred Sites Quest, aka SSQ, is a program which has evolved into a business where we are recruiting and taking students from Houston primarily, but from around the country to visit sacred spaces, and that's essentially the first part of the experience. And in their learning of the cultural diversity of these sacred spaces and the people behind these different organizations and institutions, they get a chance to take all of that knowledge and information and put it into use by creating a sacred space of their own in a foreign country, and in some cases even in their own community here in Houston. And so most recently, we've had an opportunity to recruit 18 high school kids from across the city of Houston to travel with us to Ecuador.
We had an opportunity to take the SSQ students to a public school and work with 60 young people, ages 13 through 15, and absolutely marvelous. The students were so excited about the activities. And we were really excited just to be able to bring STEM into the classroom and add the art, so STEAM actually, and it absolutely was fabulous.
I'm very excited to be here.
The musical dentist, huh?
Are you excited?
It's the musical dentist.
Yes.
Awesome. We have traveled. I am from Houston, Texas, and we have come as a group to be able to share this activity with you.
So I'm really excited to be here.
It's very, very interesting and very important for the students from Houston to be able to interact directly with them
And I can see that at the very beginning, it was a little bit of a tense, especially because of the language barrier. And we introduced the first activity, which was to build a rig. We've done this activity in the UK before. And by building a rig together, they were kind of breaking kind of barriers. And I saw a lot of the students from Ecuador starting to speak a lot more English. It was very interesting. And I also saw the students from Houston speak a lot more Spanish. Even though there was a language barrier for some of them, they were able to kind of work together because everybody knew what the instructions were, and they were able to work together in a team in spite of the language barrier.
I like how the people teach us, because they explain us very well and they don't confuse us.
My favorite part was when we built the oil rig, prepped the paper and stuff.
We had to build a form of oil rig. Like, it had to have like certain sections into it, and it had to be able to hold like 3 bags of rice. Like
had like have a cup on it and like they
poured rice into it. So that was like the weight test. I called that it's pretty lively. I called that to have a game this spring.
For me, the event was very interesting because I like robotics. For me, it's very awesome to look the drone.
I felt like we were friends at the school, and the kids that I met were really interesting and fun to work with.
For me, as a volunteer, I really enjoy to be part of these kind of programs and look for being part of the contribution for the country, because these kids will also be part of the development of the country.
And it was really awesome to find out before it was all said and done that the Secretary of Education was actually in the rear. It was really just an experience that I will treasure forever.
The importance of SSQ at a young age is that a lot of high schoolers unfortunately don't get to leave the United States. They don't get to travel until they're in college, and I think high school is when you learn most about yourself. You learn who you are, and more importantly, you learn about the world around you. And it's incredibly difficult to do so in this enclosed, sheltered bubble that I feel a lot of us are trapped within. I think high school can stop us from perceiving the cultures of the rest of the world, and something like SSQ provides students with not only the experience to engage in other cultures, but also to do so in a thought-provoking and intelligent way. Like, not only do we focus on the art of the labyrinth, but we also focus on the intellectual capability and things like Schlumberger and Steve. We can address these things, and we can encourage kids our age to pursue things like engineering.
The surface that we're using here is 477 feet. And we selected 4 or 5 kids that were kind of high school math whizzes. They were good at geometry, they were good at mathematics and angles and rays and those sorts of things. And they worked with us on translating what it was going to take in terms of materials and supplies and space to put that pattern down on the
ground.
Then we need 32.
Well, 32 people for these rays, when in fact, and again, I could be wrong here, but wouldn't having 32 people cause some of these rays to overlap?
We were trying to figure out, as the design team met the night before we went out to the Cloud Forest, we were trying to figure out what it was going to take for the group to put the design down. We had lots of strings. There were 16 rays that came from the center of the labyrinth, and we're talking about we're going to need 32 people to manage each end of these strings to make it work. And then there was a pause for a moment, and one of the questers, Harold Owens, said, "Well, wait a minute, guys. It's only going to take 16, because we're really talking about 8 rays all the way through." And so all of a sudden, the kids were telling us how it was that we were gonna have to build the cyber. And that was a great moment because I knew not only were they really bright and helpful, but they also became a real part of the build itself.
Watching the students build a labyrinth was everything. Watching the teamwork, the planning that went into it, the students taking initiative to create assembly lines and the chain gang to kind of get 15,000 river rocks into the right place was profound.
Absorb from what you need out of this experience.
The outcome was just really like satisfying that we were able to build something that so many people are gonna be able to see and, you know, just recognize that we were able to strongly put something together like that.
It was actually quite impressive how we did it in like less than 5 hours. But it looked so beautiful. It looked like it had been there for more than 10 years. It looked like it meant to exist there.
I would say my favorite part of the trip was being able to build and share the sacred archetype of the labyrinth. And especially in an area that's so biologically diverse, it was like the perfect pinnacle or culmination of spirituality and Pachamama coming together. It's amazing.
It changed my life forever in the way I look at life and the way I view life and my perspective on life. And I didn't expect this, but for me to bow down and show my respect to the outside world, just a rock that's shaped like a heart, but to me it was a energy portal, and to bow down my respect essentially to the universe and paying gratitude for this experience and for me being on this earth and for me to fulfill my purpose was transforming.
Constantly looking for students who are open-minded and willing to and ready to receive the kind of insight and experience that SSQ has to offer.
What I have learned about the Ecuadorian culture is that it's very open to people who are willing to learn about it?
Well, SSQ is important for a number of reasons. Chief among them being to get out of your comfort zone, explore the world, and broaden your horizons. In addition to that, you get to travel with people you care about, people who you can build relationships with. My favorite part of the trip was interacting with such wonderful people, and not just the people who were part of the group with SSQ, but some of the natives, because the native population of Ecuador, they're very kind, and even though there's a language barrier, they're very inviting of young students and young minds like us, like at the chocolate farm today, and at El Encanto and other places. So
we went to three different portions of the four, so every part was very different. I mean, there was a rainforest, Quito, being in the city, just very city life, the cars honking their horns, lots of traffic, lots of people. But once you got into the highlands, it was just mountains and trees and all these different animals and bugs, and it was just gorgeous.
My favorite experience would have to be the waterfall in Los Bencos. It was amazing how like the nature of the cloud forest ecosystem was able to create such a beautiful scenery.
I love seeing the Inca ruins because actually being able to travel to a part in history is truly amazing. Like, you learn that kind of stuff in school, and be able to go out and actually like physically touch what the Incas have built, that is really awesome.
My favorite place was the equator, mainly because like I never thought I'd be able to go to such an awesome place. Where when we went to the museum, I learned like so much about, you can balance an egg on a screw, and you can just do all these different things that you can't do anywhere else.
Oh yeah, food was really good.
Tried beef, which was really odd, but it was good.
I have plantains, my favorite food, so I'll make sure to have them every day now.
Food was pretty good for the most part. I think some of it was kind of weird though. For example, they served the fish with the head, which was kind of creepy, but also kind of fun to play with.
The meat pig was different. I kind of was scared to eat it, and I kind of ended up liking it, but I was kind of grossed out at the thought of eating a household pet. I didn't really feel like the youngest person, actually. I was kind of like brought in, and like I felt comfortable around the other SSQers.
I was very, very nervous coming, because not only was I new to the program, but I was new to Texas and the United States. So it was very, very nerve-wracking for me to come in with all these new people. But very, very quickly did everybody become family.
If I liked the most at SSQ, probably it is just being able to know what it's like to live with all these amazing people, and to think that I would be in Ecuador, in a place that I never dreamed of or even thought about even going ever in my life. So that probably hit the closest to home, and I'm so proud to call these people family to me.
Sharing with y'all has been so wonderful and so unexpected. I'm just really grateful. I've been stretched, and y'all have really helped me. And I didn't think I would get to learn these lessons at 15 in South America.
I think we should all take a moment. We should thank Reginald, we should thank Rhonda, we should thank all the chaperones. Thank Schlumberger for letting this amazing experience happen. You guys are changing our lives significantly. It's just something we really appreciate. We love you guys. That means so much to us. Thank you for this experience.
I will take away from this trip that you can just gather a group of people and build something and get along well, and it won't matter. Even if it's only for 10 days, you'll feel like you've known each other for much, much longer, and that you'll cross paths once again.
So as I mentioned, that was the first time he's seen it, so yes. this is what we're doing. So when you hear about the Sacred Site Quest, when you see the GoFundMe links, this is real. We're not just laying rocks and laying stones in neighborhood lots. We're changing lives. And I think in the wake of what's happened in our country over the last few days, it's made it even more important for us to do this work with our youth, because they truly are the future of not only our communities, but our country, and ultimately the world. And so I ask you all to look at within your own communities and identify young people and opportunities just like this. It was actually pretty good. I was the oddball out of the group. But nonetheless, it tastes more like pork. Yeah, it's really salty. But nonetheless, I challenge you all to go back into your communities and identify opportunities. You don't have to take kids around the world. And if you want to, we have opportunities for that. But with every community and every city and every town across the country and around the world, there are young people just like these kids that we've had a chance to work with that deserve our attention. They deserve an opportunity to unplug from this technology and tap into the power of the path. They deserve an opportunity to learn about what we are all here for, and that is what the Labyrinth does for us spiritually, personally, and professionally. So I want to thank you all for the attention. Thank you all for being here today. I want to thank all of the volunteers that helped organize this conference. I want to thank our project manager, Amy Malkin, who's been a silent giant behind some of this work. Jennifer, for being with us, helping the kids reflect on this journey. And my partner on the path, Jay Staley, I love you, man. Thank you. And thank you all for being here. I hope you enjoy the rest of this weekend. I look forward to seeing you in Galveston on Sunday. Thank you all.